time for the third Goodwin lecture. So thanks again, everybody, for being here. Thank you to this enlarged audience that we have now to listen to our invited speaker today, Professor Michael Brown. I will spend a few words on our speaker and then leave the floor to Michael. So Michael is a professor of international energy and climate change policy at UCL, University College London, the Institute for Sustainable Resources. He was previously a professor at the Cambridge University, at the Imperial College London, and at Chatham House. He's also head of climate strategies, which is a international research center, a think tank, actually, including many brilliant minds. They say they work on climate change. And it's also senior advisor on improving regulation to the UK energy regulator, Ofgem, so the Office of Gas and Electricity Markets, which is the national regulatory authority. Among the many professional commitments in his professional life, I will just mention a few ones. He acted as a consultant to the UK Climate Change Committee that advised the government for on future carbon budget and that has to report to the Parliament on the implementation of the climate change policies. And he also acted as leading author for several reports of the IPCC International Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. As far as publications is concerned, he published extensively in leading journals in the field, and he published 8 books, one of them. I don't know if it's the last one, Michael, this one. Is it? The last one in so far.
I swear there won't be another.
It was the this book entitled Planetary Economics, and I have to say that from what I saw, it has a planetary echo, to tell the truth, because it had a great impact and it still has. This was published in 2014, if I remember well. Michael came here yesterday night from Marrakesh. He was at the conference of the parties that is taking place right now in Marrakesh. So we are particularly thankful for the effort to come from Marrakesh to Siena, which is not trivial, to tell the truth. I commute from Marrakesh as well.
Almost.
And which tells you how, let's say, active he is in the climate change discussion and negotiations. And on his way from Marrakesh to Siena, he dropped me an email and said, you know what, I think I changed the title. So I said, well, Mike, I'm afraid it's a bit too late to change the program, but we'll have, we'll tell around that you decide to change the title in a very brilliant way. So we have a new title that is very up-to-date, Sustainability Trumped. And yesterday I was driving and I had my elder daughter with me, and she asked me, what does it mean? So I explained the title and she said, this is the best title I ever heard. And I was very envious, first of all. And secondly, being able to shock a teenager is a great result because it's very, very rare. Let me add just a small story before I leave you the floor. We met last time in Zurich, last summer, for the European Association conference, and it was the day after the Brexit. So we were both a bit shocked. Now you come here and we are again a bit shocked, and I want to ensure you that it's spurious correlation. It's not my fault, okay? It's not that every time you see there is such a problem. So I think I'll stop here. Let me thank in advance the discussant that you see there, Giuseppe Fontana from the University of Leeds and University of Sannio, and Massimiliano Mazzanti over there from the University of Ferrara. Actually, I want to thank you both for being here. Again, a long travel. Massimiliano just arrived from Barcelona, and they will discuss the conclusions and the intervention of Michael. So, Michael, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much for that introduction, and I'll have to see what my teenage daughter thinks about it as well when I get home. I'm aware that you've all had quite a long day already, and I'm most impressed, and I apologise that I'm going to make it even longer, and also apologise to the discussants, because of course if you're a discussant of a paper you'd like to see it in advance and have a chance to think about it. So when I emailed 2 days ago and said, do you know what, I'm going to tear up what I was going to say and talk about the present situation. Now, of course, what I want to say is based on the same intellectual foundations of what I've been planning to cover. And I will start in the same way. So yes, you need to brace yourselves a little for a few slides of some pretty analytic technical economic thinking, but I hope that you will see as I go through how I move from that into a discussion about some of the fundamentals why we're finding it so hard to get with to grips with energy and climate change, and how that may link to some of the problems in Europe, and an argument suggested at the end about the fact that if one attempts to be optimistic, which I confess is not very easy, one may help to solve the other. So I will end up on some pretty political notes, or political economic notes around the European situation. And I should also, I'm doing a lot of apologies, which is always a bad idea, but it's been a slightly bruising time in Marrakesh. Took me a while to prepare this, and there were other things, so I do apologise for having missed most of the discussions today, though some of it, fortunately, I know from attending the previous FESED conference in Brussels. So, I will try and cover 6 areas as flagged there. First, I should say, there are 2 more political sides to set the frame before I get into this sort of analytic economics, and I'll dive straight into that. Someone sent me an email on Wednesday saying, do you know, I think we're in the barbarisation scenario. And I confess, I didn't actually know this work before. I should have. It was quite an interesting website of a community that's been doing global scenarios for some years. And they just had that rough structure of potential ways in which the world could develop in the 21st century. And I think one would have to say now that compared with a few years ago, it's looking much more like one of those 2 scenarios that they rather chillingly call barbarization. We could debate which, and then discuss, is there any way that any of the sustainability or the new sustainability scenario might help us escape the worst of where we seem to be heading. In terms of if you like, starting to move on to the energy climate area, there is what I call an old narrative of climate change policy, which is broadly that it's an environmental problem, it imposes costs on others, it's an externality, it's a global one, we need to negotiate a global burden sharing deal, the most efficient response is a carbon price, and yes, some supportive measures. That approach has largely failed. We've been talking about that now for a quarter of a century since I started in this field, and the progress is clearly enormously short of what the science tells us we should be doing, And it seems to be going through another period of considerable difficulty. And now we are in a new political context as well. The onslaught of broadly separatist and populist forces. And I think that does raise other new kinds of questions. What can you actually expect of energy and climate policies in this kind of world? Believe me, it is not top of the agenda of the UK government, and that's considered one of the more forward ones, and it's certainly not in many other governments around Europe and elsewhere in the world. But can energy and climate policies make a positive contribution to economic and social development? That is now some of the driving questions. And how might they relate to what I, at least, having witnessed the UK referendum and looking at France elsewhere, now think is an existentialist threat to the European Union. So, to jump from that politics to a bit of underlying theory, a few of you may be aware of the following, but I think it is worth running through it. It's basically the intellectual framework laid out in the book that I published a couple of years ago. And it starts by a very, very simple point, I find, which is a sort of graph that says, well, in economics, we broadly have a concept of you put resources into the system and you get economic output, consumption, welfare out. And the relationship between those is broadly defined by what you can call a production frontier, a technology frontier, some kind of frontier which defines the trade-off between more resources in means more welfare out. That, of course, is involving a bundle of assumptions about, you know, representative agents optimizing their behavior. And what makes economics interesting is not that there's one line, it's that there's hundreds and thousands and millions of different resources. And I think it's fair to say that in many respects we know that markets with appropriate pricing are, for the most part, the best way of optimizing use of resources. Very good, long, intellectual foundations in neoclassical and welfare economic theory. But in reality, when we really take any individual actor, it's not quite like that. They're not necessarily at the best practice. I'm an energy economist, primarily, and I'm not actually sure I've found any rational optimizing agent in my entire professional career. Not in terms of full, if you like, optimization of energy use, or indeed many other things. So whether individuals, companies, and certainly governments, they're always some way short of where in principle they could be in a better place all round. Now, this is not a new observation at all. It's become much more respectable, I think, with the rise of behavioural and organisational economics. So all the quirks of human behaviour and of principal agent failures and contractual failures and transactions, etc. For clarity, in the book, I use the language that, well, I'm a sort of an empirical person by background. I like to start with the reality. So let's call this first domain. Let's borrow a term from economics about 60 years ago, which called this stuff satisficing. It's a very strange word, but I guess it's like, well, how can people be satisfied with not actually being optimal? But they kind of are to very important areas. Which means that the broad foundations of neoclassical economics optimizing representative agents is called the second domain. Now, okay, fine. By the way, I'm not yet making any assumptions about how important is this or what does it imply in policy terms. That's a kind of slightly other discussion. What is certainly central to what I want to say is, of course, this frontier moves. In other words, over time, we get, or can get, more out of the same or even less resource input. Oh, and I should have said resource, this could be anything, but in this context, consider it energy or the capacity of the atmosphere to absorb CO2, etc. The fact that this moves is not very exciting. Economics is quite used to the idea that, you know, productivity improves. What is really interesting is, how does it move? Where does it move? How fast does innovation move that frontier?
particularly when you have a real problem with certain sorts of resource capacities, like externalities that are certainly not priced properly. So ideally, clearly innovation could make things worse. We've got a lot better at finding more fossil fuels, for example. When you know there's a carbon problem, what you could do is put a carbon price on, which will have the effect of bending this curve backwards. It will raise the cost of using more carbon, and it will hopefully help to drive innovation in a lower carbon direction. What you really want to say, can you go in a lower carbon direction, more efficient direction, etc., but actually at an accelerated pace in terms of the well-being benefits. Now, that domain in the book therefore gets called the third domain, innovation, evolution of complex systems. And again, there's a rich theoretical literature now emerging around typically called evolutionary economics, institutional economics, complexity theory, and probably quite a few other aspects of that. So that's a kind of, it's a conceptual framework, if you like, that I found particularly useful. And useful, I think, in considering energy and climate change, perhaps more than some other areas at least, partly because this is a problem which actually spans the individual decision-making of 7 billion individuals on the planet. And to my knowledge, most of them do not wake up in the morning and think, gee, how am I going to optimise my energy use today? In fact, hardly any of them do that. But at the same time, we're looking to transform some of the most complex systems we've ever, as humanity, developed. And it is quite striking in practical terms that whereas the classical prescription would be, well, in this domain, clearly what you kind of would recommend is a market with a carbon price, then actually in practice so far we seem to have made more progress on energy efficiency policies and renewable energy technology policies and so on. Now, I could, and I had originally thought of going into rather more depth about the different domains and associated pillars. I'm going to cut a lot of that out. First, let me jump to, in this context of what I want to say, straight to the macroeconomic context, which normally I'd kind of reserve for other fora, but in this context, in the FESID. Those of you who will know sort of standard growth theory, the solo model, will also know that when, to their credit, Solo and others went to try and measure it against observed economic growth, they said, well, that's kind of funny. We seem to get a lot more economic growth than the model predicts on the basis of resource and capital accumulation only. And that's been, called the solo residual, has been an area of research. I'm sure that Malcolm and many of you would know this much better, for 5 decades. And broadly what emerges is, well, there's at least a couple of other things going on that explain the solo residual. And one of them is there seems to be sort of persistent suboptimal performance, just entities that kind of never actually get into optimizing in the way they should, or making best use of what's available. And the other is something to do with broadly the development of technology, infrastructure, intellectual capital, education, etc. So in other words, actually within the kind of language framework that I just illustrated, you kind of capture the main elements of the debate around what constitutes the solo residual. However, those things, despite being a major topic of economic research, are very poorly modelled, very poorly incorporated in models, because it's damn difficult, and consequently also rather badly charted in policy, in my experience. It's a little bit random what governments do in those kinds of areas. I think energy is a particularly strong candidate for interest here for a few reasons. Pervasive input to numerous production sectors. That means what you do in energy may propagate through the economy in much sort of more important ways with amplification effects. Fossil fuel markets are intrinsically unstable. This is a kind of classic boom-bust business cycle. You have exceptionally low rates of innovation, which I'll show in a second. Oh, and I should have said, and actually you'd have a particularly large energy efficiency gap for reasons that I think have been able to articulate rather more clearly now, but there are very
quirky characteristics of energy as a product, which I think really lend themselves to a lot of suboptimal, or whatever you call it, satisfying behaviour. But I think there's reasons this comes unavoidable in energy. The data, I think, on innovation helps to underline that. So this slightly complicated chart just makes the point that if you're going to talk about innovation, have a look at some data first, please, because you look at pharmaceuticals, biotechnology, information technology spend 10 or 15% of their turnover on research and development. Private sector, strong innovation. We are after tackle energy, climate change, we want radical innovation, oh dear, gas, utilities, electricity, industrial metals, oil industry, construction. We want radical innovation in sectors that spend a lot less than 1% of their turnover on research and development. Now, if you don't understand why that is the case, then simply throwing a carbon price at the system and expecting to suddenly get lots of low-carbon innovation is not a very smart kind of approach. I don't have a lot of time to go through the theory of this or the reasoning in the book, but it's broadly to do with the connection between the technology push and the supply pull. And in these kinds of sectors, you have rapid product development, a lot of product differentiation. You just think of the amount of money that Apple made when they produced the first iPhone. And then you say, okay, so are you willing to risk £1 billion and 10 years or more for something that will then produce another electron that's exactly the same as all the other electrons? And it's a very different kind of market structure. So you have an innovation problem. So that is a huge challenge for the low carbon transition, but it's also an opportunity. If you think about the role of innovation in macroeconomic growth, this says something about the potential benefits of actually seriously accelerating innovation in these sectors. Now, so what might you try and do about it? This, I think, is sort of one of the last of the sort of classic core charts in the book. Well, in this framework, you need to think structurally about, well, okay, which domain of behaviour am I trying to influence, and then what's the right instrument for that domain? So where you are dealing with optimising behaviour, then markets and getting the prices right is likely to be the approach of highest relevance in policy terms. And broadly what you do is you're trying to drive people to choose cleaner products and processes. If you're worried about the satisficing, you're trying to say, wait, why are we wasting so much energy? We could cut emissions and costs, etc. Well, yeah, you can probably get some of it with carbon pricing. You jack it up fast and hard. People may scream and suddenly notice they're wasting a lot of money. But in general, it's been more effective to have standards or some kind of engagement strategies. But in effect, you are therefore trying to have this supported by this to lead to smarter choices. But if what you're trying to do is really transform a system, then you really need strategic investment as the most relevant lever, which is actually remarkably easy to define. It's any investment that yields a positive social return, which cannot be fully captured by any individual entity in the market. So of course the market underinvests, and the public has to be involved in strategic investment. Predominantly, you can think of it as innovation and infrastructure. Now, in the wider context, what this does is it kind of broadens out from a focus on market liberalisation as the answer to say you've got to think about both the social dimensions in a broad term and the strategic investment dimensions, including innovation. So you've got a slightly richer terrain of economics and economic policy going on. And it's not just about energy climate policy, but that is potentially of relevance in terms of economic recovery. So now, if I therefore start to move a little bit towards some of the European situation, European economics, I think most of you, this is a simplified hugely, but you'll recognise some of the themes. The European economy has not been doing very well. The Eurozone is struggling. We do have, it seems, still quite an older debate about those who say, look, you know, we've got into this hole because we accumulated too much public debt. We can't afford
to
undermine the financial confidence with more versus obviously the Keynesian, neo-Keynesian stimulus arguments. There is deep concern about public debt, but there's masses of private money out there. And the funny thing is, a lot of it is sitting there earning almost nothing because no one is very sure where to invest. And Nadia touched very, very briefly on some of that, and I'm sure you have more widely invested. But as many have observed, the European crisis seems to be evolving from one kind of crisis into another, into another, into another. And we're now in a situation of significant social unrest, driven by the above, plus disengagement, a sense of divorce of consumer. I flagged it in a slightly odd way, but deliberately. It's a sense in which we as human beings are not very connected. And this is going back broader than I really should. But you know, as consumers, what do you want? Well, you kind of want cheaper stuff. You want a cleaner environment. You want more efficient. Well, that's nice. As a worker, actually, that's not really what you want. You want less competition. You don't want migrants taking your jobs. You don't want cheap imports. You want more demand, not less consumption. You want higher, etc. So people are both producers and consumers, and they're not terribly consistent. That's kind of life. That's politics. That's not new, but it seems to me becoming more exacerbated in some way. And I think we are pretty confused and split as to actually who and what are we around that, between these desires. Now, somewhat optimistically, I hope that the sort of framework I'm putting forward here may help in terms of navigating a way through some of this stuff. So let me then move on to this steadily moving towards the nexus here, the linkage between energy and climate and the wider economy. First, let me underline, sufficient affordable energy is really important. Economies and societies do not do very well if they don't have it. But that doesn't necessarily mean chasing the cheapest fossil fuel imports. That's been a periodic problem, as we know. And Western Europe in particular, that Europe overall, is a major fossil fuel importer. It's also a major investment sector of the economy, and particularly if you're looking at decarbonisation scenarios, you're looking at the kind of numbers tend to be banded around 100 billion euros a year. Globally, I think the figure is roughly a trillion if you looked at that graph that Nadia showed. In terms of resources, actually, having largely exhausted a lot of coal and gas within Europe itself, we have plentiful renewable resources, predominantly in rural areas, of course, and to some extent offshore as well. Because a lot of it fluctuates, cooperation between member states is quite valuable, but it's primarily domestic. And then we have a set of problems arising from inconsistency, particularly what Mark Carney, the governor of the Bank of England, called the tragedy of the horizons, but I think he's just finding a neat term for a concern that's probably been worrying many of you in FESED for a long time. Very different kinds of timescales, a real worry the financial system has become more and more short-term. Without taking you through all the words, the fact is, of course, the mere fact of being worried about climate change, which a lot of people are, does show that we also think long-term. So that's kind of another inconsistency. Now, one other feature, then, that is quite important in political economy and narrative terms, I think, is, because we will come back to pricing, don't worry, I haven't totally abandoned it. In fact, I think it's quite important. But it is also important to say, oh God, we can't have higher energy prices because we can't afford higher bills. Actually, the interesting thing is, without going through all this data, energy prices and bills are not synonymous, not given adjustment time. And when you look internationally, I keep pressing something here, hoping it will give me a red light. That's the one I should go for. No. Switched it off. That was clever. Come on. This basically shows a map of energy prices versus energy intensity. National energy bill, of course, is the price times the amount you consume. Roughly speaking, countries on this line are spending the same amount of energy. Japan, with energy prices more than twice as high as the US, is spending exactly the same proportion of its income on energy. So is France and Germany. UK is pretty close. Most of the EU is quite close. So the constancy of energy expenditure is actually quite an interesting phenomenon. Again, won't go into much detail, but what you could say going on, particularly when you consider countries, the former Soviet Union, Eastern Europe, which subsidised energy for years and years on the ground that it would be good for economic development and equity, actually they've ended up spending far more of their income because it bred such structural inefficiency. They could no longer afford the subsidy as they tried to adjust to market prices. It was actually extremely socially painful and economically painful. And climate change arguably gives us an opportunity, now that fossil fuel prices are going down again, to buck the historical pattern of just slipping back into satisficing behaviour and getting really wasteful and abandoning new investment because it's not so profitable. And hey presto, a decade later you get another energy shock. Be nice if we could avoid that pattern. As we said, another quick point on this, this is a very recent date, I chucked this in because quite a lot of work went into this, but the message is actually pretty simple. This is prices of onshore wind, offshore wind and solar over really just the last 6 years, and you'll notice two things. One is actually 2016, some prices have been way lower than anything we've seen before. And that is contracted prices. But also, there's a huge range. There's not direct comparability here, it's quite complicated putting this. I want to make both points. Renewable costs are coming down in some places. Very cheap in some places. Huge range. Why? Largely because renewables are capital intensive and therefore the cost of building this stuff is very dependent upon the interest rate. And the interest rate, or the cost of capital, or the rate of return, is very dependent upon the political and policy uncertainty of the environment. Germany, you can finance this stuff at a 3% rate of return. Makes it really cheap now after the recent falls. Greece, the figure I believe is close to 20%. So, you know, you say, oh, well, how costly is renewables? Well, tell me how stable your policy is before I answer the question. So now is an interesting time. That is actually an extraordinarily hopeful development. Renewable energy has now clearly come into the range where one could manage to keep costs within that historical constant that I mentioned in the book. It's called the Bashmore constant. Clearly renewable energy-based systems could be compatible with that level of energy expenditure. We have generally declining energy prices, which also means it's not a bad time politically to try and introduce maybe a carbon price more, because the politics obviously is a lot less if you're saying, well, energy prices won't decline quite as fast as they would have otherwise, as opposed to you're already screaming and now we're going to add another cost. We have the Paris Agreement being negotiated its first year on in Marrakesh. We have a wide set of rising geopolitical concerns, which perhaps are exacerbating concerns about dependence upon Russian gas or the Middle East, etc. And it's increasingly clear system-level changes are needed in the power sector. This is not a power sector lecture, you'll be glad to know, but believe me, there's a lot of system-level stuff going on. So now, start moving on to the policy instruments and their relationship to the economic and European themes. Okay, this bit hopefully you might recognise, and if you have been able to keep awake, it's to do with the energy innovation. And it says, well, what's the problem here, and how do we fix it? Well, the problem is, you actually need quite a lot of sustained investment in the technology push end. And you need credibility in markets and growing national, European, and global markets over time. There's a process going on called the EU Energy Union, and it tends to talk about research and innovation, but that needs to really have the second eye of innovation and investment as part of this, because investment is a major part of the learning process. Guess what? Carbon pricing could be quite useful at both of those. It generates money, and if you design it right, it may actually enhance the attraction and credibility of low carbon investment returns. So you'll note that I've moved to carbon pricing from being a conceptual thing to being an instrumental thing. What is it actually going to deliver?
In a slightly more integrated way, consider these the three pillars. Yeah, again, the same order. What it's roughly saying is, well, you know, energy efficiency will help you to manage the rising bill impact of putting the price on carbon. The price on carbon will generate revenues and help to reveal the costs emerging from low carbon innovation here, enhance the strategic value of that innovation, which in turn the technology will generate more options for responding to competitiveness, options responding to carbon price and maintaining competitiveness. And in turn, a rising carbon price will increase the tension and the whole package generating more products and potentially finance for enhancing efficiency, like buildings energy programs. And you may get more direct connections like, you know, rich Californians starting off the hybrid car boom and smart meters actually helping consumers to get smarter. So it's a package of policies that has to span all the three domains and the associated pillars. And potentially, that's a package that can raise tens of billions of pounds and attract private sector investment, perhaps with quite high leverage, if you get this right. But as I hinted, you will note that I've done a major intellectual switch from saying, well, you know, we've got a global externality problem here and we really should internalise the price. Trust me, I'm a good economist, just pay. Caricaturing, but that's kind of where some of it started. To say, now, what are the things we want to achieve here? What do we need to deliver? And how can carbon pricing help to deliver some of those things, like enhanced efficiency, enhanced investment, enhanced stability of expectations, etc. And in that, which is why I mentioned that feature about political risk driving up costs. The more you're confident about direction of travel, then the better off you're going to be. And that in turn then becomes a source of funding. Note, not just for some nice other bits of kit, but within the low carbon transition, you are actually talking about energy efficiency. Hey, that's an awful lot of people in the buildings trade going around and improving insulation, etc. Prosumers, people with solar on their rooftops, farmers with wind farms, biogas directors. Notice something? Quite a lot of it's in the rural energy sector, naturally. And likewise, the public funding for some of the public benefits around innovation, technology, etc. So, where does that relate, coming back towards the theme of Europe, and I will be moving to wind up. Looks like I've managed to keep most of you awake, and if you're not, I hope I will shortly wake you up properly. What's the essence, from an economic standpoint-ish, of the European challenge? Well, it's quite interesting. The Energy Union says, oh, you know, we've got different energy rules at a European level, but different regulatory frameworks, that can't continue. The central achievement we have made, generally known as a third package, is basically a single energy market. That's what we call it. And that's valuable. I'm not suggesting anyone should mess it up. But to take that as the only goal actually risks making it quite destructive, in my way, in the sense that at a social level, you see a lot of the resistance to freedom of movement of people. Now, it is no accident that the third package in European energy policy has focused on liberalisation, because that's the kind of main legitimacy of the main European institutions, regulatory agencies. They're all kind of basically founded in the image of second domain economics. Now, clearly the EU has done some other stuff. It's worry about climate policy. That's a third domain kind of issue. That's long term. So what's our solution? Hey, let's have a carbon price and say that solved the problem. Notice a problem? Kind of alignment of instrument and purpose, not quite ideal. And it has led to mixed results and many policy tensions. And aside from, has to be said, some of the explicit and non-economic institutions for foreign policy, almost the only ones which really have a remit at the European level are probably the European Investment Bank and R&D programmes, which are trivial compared with the national agencies in those areas. And I think this reflects a deeper issue, which is really, when you look at the history of the EU, a key moment was the Single European Act, which maybe I'm simplifying, but it kind of said, hey, the great thing about the EU is it can, is going to be the single market. That will be the defining mission of the EU from the mid-80s, which is good for aggregate efficiency, don't get me wrong, but not for the distributional implications. Well, a political entity which is defined by second pillar market liberalisation because of, you know, free movement of resources, etc., is not going to be very stable if the first and third pillars are located somewhere else. In other words, if it's the member state, the EU can blame for distributional consequences, and the member states are there, well, they do the social policy, they do most of the strategic investment, the infrastructure, etc. So you actually have a structural political divide as to who's responsible for different bits of the economic system, and some of those are much more popular than others. And you could say the Eurozone itself reflected the philosophy that, yeah, market liberalisation and extend that to a single currency, but a common currency without a fiscal capacity or a strategic capability. I think we're seeing where that's leading us. So, can I draw these threads together? Well, I'm going to try. See what the commentators make, given zero notice. First, I think it is interesting to recognise the European Union originated in energy. It was the coal and steel community was the first treaty. The next one was Euratom. Interesting. Yeah? My essential conclusion is that energy needs to be placed back at the heart of European economic policymaking. And that is the energy transformation. Now, that is not going to be funded by the United States, by the way, just in case you were hoping. I think it can be funded and guided by the needs of energy security and climate change, climate security, particularly if it includes a goal of social cohesion, inclusion, common purpose. And I think the carbon pricing can help to provide some of the finance and potentially stabilise and underwrite investor expectations in that transition, which is crucial to the recovery process. What do we do in sort of governance terms? Some things have to be done at the EU level framework. I won't run through all of those, but I'm not saying, oh, and everything must be done by the EU. We know that doesn't work and has all sorts of problems. There are some things which really must be. I think where we have not paid enough attention is at the sort of national and regional coordination levels, where there's going to be a lot of decisions around, for example, infrastructure interlinkages, where the EU Energy Union is struggling, coordination of renewable demand pull. We have a problem around state aid rules as a constraint in this area, in my view, but lots of interesting regional stuff you can do. And I think a key element is to have a price floor on the carbon pricing systems. Where and how? Well, it's politically tricky in individual member states. It's politically impossible at the EU level, I fear. Might be interesting to look at enhanced cooperation clauses or Eurozone. Could the Eurozone introduce a carbon price corridor or some kind of carbon-backed investment guarantee? With some very interesting work, in my view, really interesting, looking at the possible role of central banks issuing credit lines which are underwritten by a rising carbon price guarantee. Again, the theme being, this is a big deal, this is a lot of investment, and it's uncertainty that deters the investment that you need for either climate or economic recovery. And I've been very interested in the work under Fesser presented on a network of green investment banks, or whatever you call it, because the money has to be spent, and it can't be spent from Brussels. You have to have national or even regional fiscal capacity, but drawing upon, in my view, the carbon pricing system at the appropriate levels, and with those banks doing some of the stuff that we do see some regional development banks doing in terms of development. And that is, again, tapping on the features of the energy transition. So I'm going to stop there, but my final slide is actually simply, that's partly because we're here in Italy, but it's actually a bit more than that.
I think there are reasons why the Italian situation is quite interesting. Italy has very good renewable energy resources. It does not have a very good energy system. I think it has an interesting role in the Eurozone. I think France is committed more to nuclear power. Germany, we know their Energiewende, but also their fiscal rectitude and various other features, and the politics now in Germany are very difficult. UK, well, I'm not sure what I can say there, except in questions. So I do think that actually thinking about the role of Italy in fostering this process and this transition could be a very topic, very interesting topic for discussion. Let me say no more than that. Thank you very much.
The microphone? I don't think so. Are you okay? Or I think, can you hear me?
Maybe better with the microphone.
Okay. So I should start really thanking Alessandro Vercelli, Simone, and their team of friends, Sebastiano is there, and colleagues here in Sierra, for the kind and generous invitation to be discussing here on the third Goodwin Lecture by Professor Graf. And I should also, as I was saying personally before to Professor Grabi, that my contribution to the debate of this evening is really modest. I think Simone well explained that Professor Grabi is a distinguished academic with a wealth of accumulated wisdom as advisor to national and international organizations on several projects and issues, including, and I think that was at the heart of his talk this evening, the intimate relationship between energy and climate change, and more generally, I would say, on global warming. So my modest contribution really comes from, you know, before actually Professor Graf was asked, where are you coming from with your comment? I said, well, I will draw on my FESUD post-Keynesian economics research interest, as well as my role as the president of the Association for Social Economics, and the type of question that I think people often with great passion discuss within the association, as well as in broadly defined post-Keynesian economics, in particular in that area of the environment goes under the name of ecological macroeconomics. So let me say something about the main thesis put forward by Professor Graf tonight and his long-standing work. Well, he put forward a set of suggestions which act as the necessary condition to align in a sustainable way the intimate relationship that we have in the real world between energy and climate change. And particularly focus on the possibility of reducing the energy consumption and emission. Now, this condition, which I think that were discussed today by Professor Graf, require policy change in three domains, as he was saying, of satisfying, optimizing, and transforming. In the first domain, and I hope I will, I grabbed your certain the main point, is that firms, households neglect cost-effective ways of, to save energy, such as investing in insulation that promises a reduction in energy bills. And here the role of the policy is to make consumption of energy more efficient by fostering changes in social norms, habits, what Keynes will call conventions, relating to energy use and climate change. For instance, here we can talk about the introduction of new standard for home appliances, houses, cars. And I think this is the domain where social economics could play an important role, because they do stress the role of social norms, habits, and convention, and the way in which agents behave. The second domain of optimizing, here firms, households are, I would say, and please forgive me if I misunderstood you, are the economic agents of neoclassical economics. Are rational agents, they optimize every economic decision by responding correctly to the price signals. And so here the role of policy is to use the power of the market in order to introduce the set of mechanisms and schemes, and we can discuss an example of it, that allow rational agents to shift toward an economy that has a clear way of using energy for the good of the entire society. And here I think we can use the case of carbon taxes that you were mentioning in cap and trade schemes that through the market mechanism allow the trade of emission allowances. The third domain that you were discussing is the one you called of transforming. I think firms household here fall somewhat in the background, where the government, the other institutional investor and funders take the central stage of the analysis. The focus here, and you hinted that when you talk about macroeconomic growth, is the long-run trend of economic development. And here again, I think you stress different countries and different regions, so highlighting the spatial dimension that, for instance, in financialization and in FESUD we have highlighted. And here the role of policy is to support the evolution toward more efficient and lower carbon energy system by helping the financing and the funding. And here I'm in Italy, so I should make that distinction, goes back to the work of Augusto Graziani, between financing and funding, that I think sometimes people forget, but I think it's very important, of technological changes. And here, of course, the important role is for innovation and strategic investment in infrastructure. And here I think the domain is where evolutionary institutional economics, and I would say more broadly defined post-Keynes economics, can play an important role. I mean, yes, you do highlight, for instance, tension between the consumer and producer and civil citizen, if you want. But again, what economics, and in particular post-Keynesian economics and FESUD can teach us, is the insustainability of some economic model of development, like a debt-led consumption growth model that we have experienced the last 20 years. So I think there is quite a lot that we can learn from your third domain. So let me summarize very briefly what I think Professor Grob was arguing, and some question for him. So if I understand correctly, you were arguing that in order to align in a sustainable way energy and climate change, policy change in all three mutually reinforcing domains of satisfying, optimizing, transforming are necessary. And here I think I will stress what you are saying, they have to be mutually reinforcing. Now, my personal view is that your arguments are compelling. And for obvious reason of time, and also because I have the role of being a discussant, so I have a critical role here, I cannot say more about the agreement, and in fact I welcome your argument. So let me ask you a couple of questions that I think are the main challenges for the argument you have put forward. And it's basically how policy should be designed and implemented in each of the above domains. If I understand correctly, in your first domain of satisfying, firms, households are social economic agents. In the second domain, they are rational, in the sense of neoclassical economics, rational economic agents. And the third domain, and here we're talking in particular of government, the other financing and funding institution, they are, if I get correctly, yes, they are evolutionary agent. So my questions for you are, how policy can be designed and implemented in a way that is consistent with this different interpretation of economic agents? What are the set of assumptions, concepts, and values behind these policies? Academics that have working in social economics, in classical economics, in evolutionary / post-Keynesian economics, hardly know each other's works, let alone working together. Could policymakers succeed where academics have failed? How do they do it? Also, and leaving behind any speculation about the new political climate, I loved your title, I must say, as well, though I'm not a teenager. So leaving aside Brexit, US presidential results, etc., how policy can be designed and implemented in a way that is consistent with continuously changing, if not challenging, national, international political agenda and interest? We live in UK, you know, 6 months ago, no one will have predicted the result of Brexit. So we don't know what will be the Brexit. We discuss hard, soft Brexit. No one will have predicted 6 months ago the result of US presidential result. And no one can predict what will happen to the referendum in this country and the possibility of election in this country and so on and so forth. Or the French result of the elections in a few months' time. So how policy can be designed and implemented in a way that is consistent with this challenging environment, political environment? Thank you very much.
Now time for Massimiliano Mazzanti from the University of Ferrara to give us his talk.
Okay. First of all, I really thank you for inviting me here, and it's an honor to discuss Professor Grubb. One of the reasons that we are both former UCL students and have many links with UCL. My discussion is a series of comments, and I do think I will provide some complement ideas. I came across in the email with the new title, so I think that some of the issues I will touch on are in relation to the recent shocking events in, from an economic perspective. But my UCL legacy is also recently assessed. I had the opportunity to read some of the chapters thanks to Paul Eakins, who shared for this project. I had been some feedback. So I only use. Sorry. This one is. Okay. So I just use this slide there, which is the usual scenario about the current policy and the what we have to do in the future, mean to present the situation. I was yesterday in the airport. I had to wait for 2 hours, so I downloaded some data from Eurostat. We're just searching for the. Okay, that's fine. And simple stuff mean that this is the reduction in greenhouse gas changes in some countries. Okay, you also have plus GDP. Okay, this is the greenhouse gases on GDP. Okay, so you see, so very basic stuff mean. I use this simple slide to highlight two facts. One, the very trivial ones. One, we have stronger reductions, but some of those reductions are due to delocalization and this deindustrialization in advanced countries, which is part of the political story, okay, in electoral terms, okay. It's also an environmental problem. And then the issue I would like to raise today is a research hypothesis, an issue that we have touched upon in the previous years and in our current research. It is also a political issue, it is convergence. Okay. My impression is that macroeconomic indicators, economic environmental indicators, are not really telling me the right story. In the US, macroeconomic indicators, the UK as well, are pretty good. Okay. Nonetheless, you have regional problems, regional variations that are not represented by macroeconomic. So you have the average, also the variance. Okay, very true. So those are my 2 points. Okay, very trivial, but I would like to discuss those with you. So we have massive cuts. But convergence and also CO2 shifting should be analyzed. For example, expected evidence, imported emissions embodied in imports to the EU, to China, okay? We may have other countries in the southeast. So we are importing. It's also a policy problem because we are having for some years the sustainable energy. Sustainable from the consumption side and production side. So we have to look at both sides of the story. Why the policies are set on the basis of production, okay? So things are changing. Again, this is repetitive again, but it's evident. So that's what I was saying, okay? A very good reading, I think it's the recent UNIDO Industrial Development Report, which is structured on technology innovation and sustainable development. They are going to prepare a specific report on manufacturing. They re-stress the fact that development is based upon manufacturing and stronger national features, more than competitive advantages. Okay. I start the role of manufacturing because it's linked to the past slide. It is linked to the evolution of economic systems in the advanced OECD world and elsewhere. Another issue, for example, you see here, this is a decomposition analysis. Least developed countries, developing, emerging countries, industrialized. Emissions are dependent on growth, composition effects, efficiency, okay. And you see that the role of innovation is different. For example, in industrialized countries you have a strong component here, even in emerging countries, but have a deficiency. So it's good to analyze how economic systems are moving towards a low carbon economy in terms of innovation and structural change. And you may find different stories behind different areas, different countries, and different regions. Okay, so that's another point. So, okay. Something we have to bear in mind is that, again, linked to manufacturing and innovation, we have low carbon economy targets, but also non-binding but strategic targets about reindustrializing the EU. Okay, and one of the reasons that manufacturing is more innovative, value added desire. Okay, so one non-binding strategy is to move from the current 15% to 20% of manufacturing share in total GDP. Without innovation, emissions are going to increase, okay, other things being equal. So we have a short-term trade-off between the two industrialization and low-carbon economy strategies, okay. Again, heterogeneity within the EU, which is a problem that we are stressing, and so again, convergence, divergence issues are maybe overlooked and should be analyzed through macroeconomic models, regional studies type of analysis. This egg innovation in the EU, the only data we have, you see in the heterogeneity about egg innovations, again, just empirical figures. You see the strong role of Germany, maybe the too strong role of Germany in terms of technological leadership, okay. Compared to other countries, which may create imbalances. Okay. So linking to this kind of Brexit, Trump, and maybe other events, my impression is that economic facts linked to within country differences, increasing differences, may have played a role, may play a role, okay? So we have to bear in mind this fact when we move to policy situations in any kind of policy factors, okay? For example, I have three slides to finish my talk. In a forthcoming study that we don't have the working paper today, we find that by using the wired data set, the human factoring sectors present some kind of beta convergence, but not sigma convergence, okay? And you see that those are used sectors in terms of the environmental productivity, or say, again, greenhouse gases on value added, okay? And there is a kind of, for example, here, only two sectors, leather and coke and refinery, are witnessing a kind of reduction in variation, okay? So again, we have a lot of regional, geographical, sectoral type of variation that may affect economic and political conditions, okay, in this economic environmental type of transition towards a circular economy, low carbon economy, and increasing GDP as well, which is not really the case today, okay. So final point. I stick to the current EU macroeconomics linked to the green economy. I may be, again, very trivial, going back to simple things, but I agree with Professor Grant that the narrative about ecological tax reforms, carbon pricing has it is a bit fragile, so we have failed at the something which has not been communicated very well there. So we need more stuff, maybe and other type of narrations. But again, if we observe the bizarre and tragic EU situation, again the role for ecological tax reform and carbon pricing is pretty substantial today. Even that inflation is still very, very low, and inflation is the problem. I mean, deflation, not inflation, is the problem, at least in continental Europe. And growth rates are very different across areas, okay? So we could also support Draghi, Mario Draghi efforts through ecological tax reform to some extent, through the type of of actions. Final slide. Linking maybe some welfare economics, more Keynesian economics, or with innovation in between. I do think that the combination of carbon pricing, and here underline linking my talk to the ETS presentation. I do think there is an original area of research, at least in political economy realms, to understand how the revenues are going to be used by countries in funding what in different realms. This is the estimation coming from the Cecilia 2050 project time I mentioned, okay. In terms of 2050 price, but you also need public investments to activate green demand. Okay, and here I recall the debate in that occurred in 2009. For example, in the G20 in April 2009 about green recovery packages. Okay. And everything was a bit lost after that 2009-2010 type of debate, and I don't have to say here in Siena that investments drive saving and not vice versa, but in many other departments some scholars could say the opposite, okay. It's not a joke, but okay, just to say that we need investments because GDP growth is not really high, unemployment is very high, inflation is very low, So carbon pricing plus investments, more green demand to achieve this type of transition. Okay. So very simple thoughts, but I hope to have provided complement ideas. Okay. Thanks.
So thank you, Massimiliano, also for reminding us the correct direction of causality in your final point. I will take some questions from the audience maybe, and then I will ask Michael to answer the discuss some suggestions and plus any possible question you raise. Maybe I'll break the ice.
I think very briefly,
there is a ghost in the room that didn't show up entirely, which is Donald Trump. It was in the title, and I expected to find it also in the presentation. So I want to be explicit.
Yeah.
Very general question, but how things are going to change after this week's result. I read a Twitter by Richard Tull, who said climate change is the least problem now. And if Richard Tull says that, you know, a person who works on this, has been working on this for ages, it's somehow worrying. It is true, I agree with Tull on that, but I'm afraid things are going to change also for our profession, pretty much. So just my provocation and that I want to throw on the floor.
I have another question, which is I was very intrigued by your proposals about the possible reforms in the energy sector, possible creation of clubs within the European Union through the enhanced cooperation. However, I think what I would like to know is your opinion about the role of globalization over there, because I think actually probably in our present scenario it would make more sense to work on carbon clubs or climate clubs at the global level rather than creating an enhanced cooperation. I don't see the value too much of an enhanced cooperation in this area only within the European Union. I would rather confront with the global dimension. And I think that the global dimension is actually playing a big role in all these crises, in the Trump issue, and even in the Brexit, I think, more than we think.
Yeah.
And the other point, if I may, is about sustainability. What do you think about the link between your integration agenda, energy, climate change, and economic issue, and how this can be framed in a way that can help promoting sustainability, right? Environmental sustainability, at least I'm interested more in this dimension.
Yeah.
There are a couple of more questions.
Yeah.
Yes.
All right. Yes, the Jan Pobrowski from the SOAS. We worry a lot about getting 28 countries in Europe to cooperate on climate change when actually, my question is really, will the efforts of China not have much bigger effects than what we can achieve by cooperation in Europe?
Shall I take those together actually, and then come back for others? Because
maybe
they link more.
Okay.
Maybe it is probably related to the others. You said that the old narrative of climate policy has largely failed. I agree with you, and I think that one important explanation for that is the overconfidence that was entertained in the recent decades on so-called market-based instruments. Because after all, sustainability implies constraints to the market, and so policy should have the courage to enforce these constraints. I saw, but my question is the following. I understood many important, interesting hints of a different narrative, alternative policy strategy, but I didn't understand the plan behind that, and in particular, what sort of instruments you think should be used by the new policy strategy.
Right. Okay. Quite a few big questions there. And I know we had the others as well. Let me try and take them in the following order and see if I can say anything sensible at all. In terms of the internal European, why even consider a sort of internal clubs? It is partly just the straightforward political economy. I do think, and there's a sort of irony in this, I mean, I've written this sort of more than 500 page book, which basically agrees at enormous length with what you just said, which is, you know, one of the reasons we're in a mess is because we treated the whole thing as an internalization problem where the market price should solve everything. And it didn't, and it wouldn't, and it couldn't. And the paradox is, I to some extent come full circle to thinking this cannot work without carbon pricing. Because without carbon pricing, you kind of don't have either the steering wheel of strategic relative future values, nor do you have the fuel of investment, of finance associated with the problem. And in effect, the strategy is you tax the bad to fund the good in a problem which is a deep combination of both. The political economy problem is I do not see Poland or Eastern Europe being willing to agree an adequate carbon price to do that job. And when actually also you look at Giuseppe's slides, you can kind of see why, which is they're two or three times more energy intensive than Western Europe. So it hurts them a lot more. And a lot of them are coal-based. And so there is an economic and social reality underpinning that opposition. So I'm not convinced the solution is to try and force Eastern Europe to have a carbon price that it finds politically untenable, particularly given the febrile nature of European politics. So my instinct is I do think it can make economic and political sense if you could design it, for example, across the Eurozone. It helps to have a lot more than one country. The more, the easier, in one sense. And I think then it might also link into some of the macroeconomic and finance side of literature I hinted at briefly. And then Europe would have to accept somewhat differential internal carbon prices. But remind us, California has a very different carbon price than the rest of the US economy. They manage it. And in fact, they try and discriminate the kind of electricity trade that you can have and the contracts you have. And there's serious talk about doing the same with cement trade and other stuff. That's within a single nation state. So there's no fundamental reason why Europe couldn't consider. We've just got so used to thinking of the EU ETS as, you know, a great achievement, which in a sense it was, but it's not going to do the job now. That was rather long-winded. When we come on to the more international phase, yes, of course you're right that what China does now in emission terms is going to be a lot more important than what the EU does. I mean, the statistics are staggering. You know, you go back, I think, just to 2000, and China was emitting half of the US. 2008, and it was emitting the same as the 2006, 2008, so same as the US, and now it's emitting almost twice as much as the US. Phenomenal emissions transformation in entirely the wrong direction. That has stabilised. The Chinese are really worried about climate change. I think it is, we underestimate the importance of the Kyoto Protocol and the fact that the rest of the world stuck with it because that was seen as the symbol of industrialized country leadership, which was the prime principle of the original UN Convention. So there's a sense the fact that European emissions have gone down substantially and they stayed in that system, and US emissions have subsequently started to follow going down, is enormous help to the political economy and the geopolitics of China saying, okay, fine, you know, it's been a bit rocky, a bit incomplete, but we accept, we're now fundamentally part of the solution, we cannot dodge that. Now that then takes me on to your question about Trump. And I was sort of conscious that having put that in the title, I only addressed it very obliquely by clearly implying that, well, you ain't going to get a global burden sharing deal, including the US, in the next 4 years. And if Europe is going to stick at this, it's going to have to do it in a very different way, which is consistent with the political challenges within the EU and upon the EU from a US government, which basically has just announced it's going to try and withdraw for the future. The Trump government, which will try and withdraw from Paris, cancel the international finance, etc. We have been here before. Yeah? This is exactly where we were in the year 2000, when President Bush pulled out of the Kyoto Protocol. At that time, it's clear the US assumption was, well, that's it, the system will collapse, fine, that's what they want. I think Donald Trump is acting on the same assumption. I think when you look at what comes out of Marrakesh next week, he'll get the same answer, which is, sorry, but you are not going to dictate to the rest of the planet what happens to the planet. It must be absolutely fascinating, the discussions going on now, of course, with the democratic representatives of what is currently still a democratic president locked in rooms talking to the rest of the world about how to handle the new situation. The big difference is that in 2000, Europe was relatively strong in the international system. In 2016, it's China that is relatively strong in the international system. And I have already seen people saying, okay, so what this means is that China is now going to be the determining leader of what happens on climate change. Within that context, I return to the question about Europe, because I think that does then actually say, look, I mean, China does want to solve this problem now. It absolutely accepted it's part of it. It has an emerging emissions trading system. It's going to launch its federal system next year. Of course, it will be imperfect and messy like the European one was in the first and third phases. But they're going to want a dialogue. You know, who's still with us? Who actually wants to solve this problem? And what kind of deals do we need to cut in order to cope with the Trump presidency? And yes, that then leads you into the discussion of carbon clubs. How do you structure international deals in a world which is clearly not going to be all acting together? You need to look at new policy instruments, and I'm sorry I couldn't sort of go in more depth there. But I think there are quite, you know, there are some interesting possibilities. And we may either have to look at putting more of the emphasis upon consumption-based charging, like charging for energy-intensive materials to avoid the carbon leakage problem, or we will get a renewal of the academic analysis of border adjustments. Now, in the early 2000s, the discussion about carbon border adjustments was like, you know, US and EU back, you know, get together and try and impose some kind of border adjustment vis-a-vis China and emerging and developing countries. That's not going to be the geopolitical context of any trade-related debates now. It's going to be about trade liberalisation for clean technologies and charging for carbon-intensive commodities. Of which it looks like Trump is determined to make America the lead again. So we'll see. But no, it's not an easy situation. China is not used to the idea of being a geopolitical leader, but it's going to have to get used to it pretty quickly, and it will want to know, is the EU with them?
Thank you. You just mentioned that Europe now is weaker compared to 2000. And I would like to go back to your title about integration of the European energy system in an age of populism. So I wonder to what extent more Europe, and I'm just quoting the title that the European Institute of Galaxy was using just a couple of years ago, is better. So to my understanding, there is a need of a very strict integration of the transmission system and an extreme level of cooperation among the different member states if you really truly want to go towards an energy union, right? So can you elaborate on that? Can you tell us a little bit more about what is your view about that?
There is one question from the students, one point more.
Professor Grom, I'm wondering the emergence of Trump from the US immediately, and then the exit of Britain. In 2 years, it's getting out. Between now and the next 2 years, Britain is preparing to get out, so it might not be necessary concerned with issues of integration of energy processes in the European Union. So what role would the UK play in trying to, you know, to look at issues of policy at a physical level? Thank you.
Well, I guess Brexit was bound to come up. The short answer on Brexit is I don't know, and nor does anyone else. The reason why nobody knows is that there was a referendum in favour of leaving the EU. There was no consensus as to what actually that meant. And so the natural next step of the evolution was to say, well, did that mean leaving the political or the actual leaving the single market? And that has already split the Conservative government. We've already seen one minister resigning because of that. Another minister's gone. The government's majority is now 7 rather than 9, I think, if I've got the numbers right. And there's at least 20 or 30 diehards on either side of the camp as to whether they should stay in or outside the single market. Theresa May is doggedly determined that there shall not be another general election. It's kind of looking hard to see how she will stick by that and get a clear decision, but I may be proved wrong. But I'm simply answering in a long term that in terms of actually what it means in terms of economic integration, nobody really knows yet, because Britain still has not actually taken the most important decision. There's a huge desire, I think, slowly emerging to try and have a kind of piece-by-piece negotiating about, well, clearly, you know, migration was the dominant issue, but please let's kind of stay part of most of the rest of the single market stuff. And of course, the rest of the EU is saying, sorry, this is not pick or choose, because then the entire union unravels. I have heard some tentative, maybe more serious discussion about whether it's possible to carve out energy as a separate category in the single energy market as something that the UK might stay part of. I wouldn't bank on it at all. But the fact is, the physical benefits of interconnection are very considerable. And in fact, so far, the investment in physical electricity interconnectors has held up reasonably well. But politically as well, Britain just doesn't know where it stands in its relations with Europe. I mean, some of the cabinet, you know, clearly just think they'd much rather do deals with China and the US than with the EU. And others are saying, no, Brexit means we're still all really good friends and we'll all get on extremely well together and we'll all help each other. Nobody's got a clue in terms of where this goes in UK politics. Then to come on briefly to the European Energy Union and the European Union's situation more generally, I guess, I'm speculating, I'm not a scholar of EU affairs directly, I observe it. What's going on really clearly there are some very horrible scenarios. right? Let's be honest. You look at the French elections coming up, you look at etc. It's not at all obvious that EU will exist in anything like its current form in another few years. And we know historically what that can do. And of course, yes, Richard Toll's right, lots of other people right, my Australian friends right, in the new world there are bigger challenges. This really came home to me when in Marrakesh I was talking with someone from Estonia, a leading researcher, Estonia, based now in the UK, and she said, well, with Brexit, I don't know if I can stay in Britain, with Trump, it looks to me likely that we could be invaded. Last time her country was invaded by Russia, half her family was killed. Yeah? I mean, we think we have worries. Just put yourself in those shoes. I think that was a deviation, but, you know, we do need to be realistic about some of the things. I think where it reminds me of is the broader versus deeper debate that we had in Europe for a long time. I think we've tried broadening. We tried broadening to 28 member states. We were unlucky in terms of the timing of the financial crisis. We've not handled it very well in various ways. I think what is now happening, if it doesn't entirely disintegrate, probably drives us back towards deepening, in which you have a Eurozone core, and maybe the EU politically holds together in its current form without the UK. But even so, I think there's got to be a stable Eurozone core that is economically healthy in order, I think, for Europe to get anywhere on this. And it strikes me that should be the overriding priority of policymakers. Now, principally, you know, between Germany, Italy and France and the Benelux countries. And I guess what I've tried to do is say, by the way, there is a role for energy in trying to carry that through properly. And I genuinely believe that, actually, from what I've seen. And I think part of the pity is I think the central policy, economic policy makers don't realise the opportunities there could be in the energy sector.
Hello, Professor. I had, in fact, two questions, short questions. The first one is linking the thing with the energy, the same program energy of the European Union, and you compared it with the carbon and steel agreement or European recovery program when Europe started to have the integration. We know very well this European recovery program started after big mistake from Europe or the Second War. So practically everyone saw the consequences of the mistakes they made, and after, of course, they was able to make this agreement, everyone to make something to for a bigger agreement.
Yeah. Yeah.
So the question is, do we need again a big mistake to go in a certain point, there's no, let's say, turn back and to find the agreement finally, or because, you know, the people doesn't believe the consequences if they don't look in the face. And the second question is, do you think the populism is good, or let's say a good, maybe a good solution in short terms to solve the climate problems? I'm thinking now about Latouche, who says the growth gonna resolve the climate environmental problems. The populism in this case I am connecting with the protectionist economies, so practically the opposite philosophy all the Eastern countries follow it until now, or the, I'm talking about the Chicago School's theories or neoliberalist theories, which means integration, globalization, and all this stuff. Populism in this case, we are seeing populism like the devil, practically the enemy of all the environmental problems, economic problems. But connected to Latouche thing, maybe populist protectionism means also the growth, and also indirectly connect with a short solution in terms of environmental problems. Thank you.
I'm not sure I fully understood the last point. I think first, obviously, one way of reducing environmental pressures is potentially reduced economic growth. I don't think it's a very smart approach. I don't think it is a socially or politically acceptable one. It may happen, but I would not recommend it. Economic growth can be both a problem and solution. It depends upon how you shape it. The economy is there to be shaped in terms of how it evolves, and including in relation to environment issues. And that's a matter of public policy around the structure of economic growth and the direction of innovation, which is part of the point. In terms of populism and your early, the question, do we have to make a big mistake? Well, I think the thing that really strikes me is an old saying that history does not repeat itself, but historical situations do recur. And I think we know what kind of historical situation could be recurring. The question, therefore, is, do we repeat the same mistakes? And you could argue that so far we seem to be doing pretty well at making the same mistakes. Yeah? I mean, you trace it back to the 1929 Great Crash, the initial response, retrenchment, recession, trade barriers, isolationism, rise of fascism. We know where that went. But you can rewrite that narrative. Different people, different social groups, different countries played particular roles in what happened then. History does not have to repeat itself. I think my big worry is, I think quite a lot of the European elites know that. But I think a lot of the people that voted for Brexit, that voted for Trump, that are voting for Marine Le Pen, that was kind of two decades ago. They're used to a different world. I think a lot of people don't know where this could lead if we do make the same mistakes. And I do think we need a sort of more reinvigorating European narrative. And I think that can actually, I think there is some mileage in the, the common social purpose, including in relation to things like, sustainability. But history may say that's wishful thinking, or it may actually judge otherwise. And I think probably, speaking of sustainability, I'm not sure about all of you. You've done very well, but probably time to draw to a close there on that note.
Yes, even because you have a new narrative to tell for the future, relations, maybe for our future projects and for the sustainability. So, time to close, time to set Michael free, and we thank again Michael Graf for being here for your